Hello and welcome back to Black Couch Reviews. I'm your host, Christina. We are back for the finale of Barry, Season 1, Episode 8, Chapter 8, Know Your Truth, written by Alec Berg and Bill Hader, also directed by Alec Berg. Gave this episode a 9.6 out of 10. I really enjoyed it, even though I was very depressed at the end. Everything was going so very well, where it looked like, okay, I can see how this show is going to reformat itself for the second season. And then in the last 10 minutes, shit got dark.
No. Wait. Wait.
Before we get into it, wherever you're listening to this podcast, Apple Podcasts, Podbean, Stitcher, Spotify, do me a favor, go down to the rating section, drop some stars, leave a review. My social media will be there as well. Remember to like, share, and subscribe. And if you want to send feedback for Barry Season 2 or any other show that I do, blackgirlcouch@gmail.com. Let's get into it. Barry, he busts in on Fuchs, who's Fuchs. Did I say Fuchs? Fuchs, who is still hungover and is being told that he's going to be killed. But I guess the only thing he could do is hold a gun and point it towards the door and threaten someone who's trying to get in with said weapon. But it's Barry. He doesn't say a word as he goes to where their money is, grabs what is rightfully his, but Fuchs tells him it's my money.
Excuse me, bitch?
Barry isn't having it though, and not only does he punch him in the face once, but he punches a second time, knocking his tooth out, being like, you got me into this shit. I said I was done. I'm out.
Fuck this shit, I quit.
No more killing starting now. Except now is not quite now. Because all he does is go to the beach. Meanwhile, Fuchs decides, because he's pissed off Barry stole the money, his money that he earned, goes to Goren, who is on a Stairmaster and is shown in by Noho Hank and offered, a submarine sandwich. You hungry? You want something to eat? And he says, look, I came here to you because Barry's alive and I know where you can locate him, immediately selling him out.
Pussy ass bitch.
This man has absolutely no loyalty, which pisses me off that he finally is about to get what's coming to him, as Goren's like, I don't need you for that. I know he's going to the acting class. And I don't care that you showed up here. You really fucked shit up for me. But I hate to say it, was correct when he said, I just asked you what you wanted. You said the stash house. So, I mean, I just say get what you want. So he brings in Vash's twin brother, who's basically Pepe Le Pew. He just got some mustache on him. And he tells him he's about to kill you and to chop him up in little pieces. And he gets the saw like, shush, I don't want to hear what you have to say. And I thought finally Fuchs is going to be dead and I'm going to be excited and that's going to be great. But unfortunately, it does not go down like that. They decide to go after Fuchs is dead to the acting class to kill Barry. Now that they know that he is alive, Hank is all down for it. But Goren says, you're not really a second in command. You're kind of a piece of shit because you did the whole lipstick camera, which got us in this situation to begin with. You got shot by Barry. Are you in love with him? He said no, but we all know what his true feelings are.
It's tearing up my heart when I'm with you. But when we are apart, I feel it too. And no matter what I do, I feel the pain. With or without.
Hank is like, look, I'm just a nice person. He's like, well, you can stay here with the bitch, aka my wife, and do the dishes because that's where you deserve to be. So Noho Hank texts Barry and tells him, I know you're alive, answer the phone. Then he calls him and he says, so Fuchs was captured and you should totally get away as far away as possible because they're planning on killing you. Aww, he he was his friend, and all he said was thanks. He's like, by the way, Foost is probably gonna be dead because we hear sawing, and unfortunately he's not dead, and this definitely was not tipping him off to save Fuchs, who he does not give a shit about, because he didn't know at this point that Vasha's twin was over there building a guillotine so that he could torture him even more by making him watch the device that he's going to build to kill him before chopping him up into stacks, and that'll be easier to transport. Gordon is like, this is some bullshit, and takes a gun and is about to kill him himself. And Barry, of course, somehow shows up in the nick of time. Smart. I forget how smart that Barry is, how lethal he is. We're reminded last episode, and particularly this episode, of the havoc in which he can wreck, particularly when his mind is put to it. And though he has been seesawing all season about his killing, when he needs to get the job done, particularly around self-preservation, he is willing to go very far as it needs to go. And unfortunately, that means that innocent people, truly innocent people, this ain't no Dexter bullshit, which I love how they played on that, that he's killing bad people. No, he's unfortunately besmirching the name of really good people, and we see that he killed some really good people. But the smart bit was killing them from a low angle so that the cops believe that the Bolivians killed them, because they are known to be shorter. So he kills them all from a low angle. He tells, I hated Fuchs when he was like, Barry, is that you? Are you coming to save me? And he's so happy. But he takes him to the airport. He's clearly still done with him, but he says, you know, you raised me to be this way, and I'm still out. And he gives him all the money and kicks him out the car at the airport, telling him to leave Los Angeles. The LAPD, Janice in particular, gets a warrant finally for Bazaar. However, as they're on their way, the shootout happens very coincidentally. Noho Hank comes out with tea, because he really did take his job seriously in the kitchen. And when he realizes what has happened, he says, Barry, and he's happy because he tells him, you know, you're a good person, you're a good friend. And when he realizes that the cops are coming, he's like, okay, guys, let's go, because I think they're definitely here coming for us. Let's get rid of the situation. We later see Noho Hank with Cristobal, and he has decided to broker a peace between him and the Bolivians, because now that Goren's out of the way, he started the whole war. He's like, go mingle with them. It's like, you're very polite. And he's like, thank you. And they appreciate that about each other, whereas Goren was brute force. I wonder how this new relationship is going to be, but they do seem to be mingling and rather toast each other as they're watching events unfold on the news, as they now believe concretely, even though it was Loesch that's like, nah, it can't be the Bolivians. But unfortunately, the evidence does point to the Bolivians. I find it ironic that she was right about it being Barry, and they thought it was the Bolivians. And then he was like, oh no, this had to be someone else. And then they're back to the Bolivians. During the press conference, Jean calls Janice from the store saying, you look hot on camera. I love this so much, because you can see her in the camera looking over like, oh my god. He's like, you owe me a kick in the balls now that you solved the case. He's like, okay, I understand you had to put this shit on pause, things were too close, I respect that, I know you an independent woman, but now that the case is closed and everything's tied up, Taylor, that whole thing was supposedly orchestrated by Ryan. Chris was not mentioned, but I'm sure his dead body, maybe they thought that Chris was involved. I do have a question that I am going to bring up that was a bit of and they could still bring it up next season. But there is a little bit of a hole in the recognizing of Taylor, particularly because they did a press conference. If they didn't, then I'd be like, okay, well, you know, but because they did a press conference, and it's about a drug gang war, I don't know. I feel like someone from the acting class should have came forward. But so let's continue on, and we'll get back to that point later. But that was really cute. And he goes to the acting class bar. He sees Sally, who's very excited to see him now, has forgotten all about her ill treatment. And she says, I see that you're a good actor, and I don't tell many people that. As he says that he's going to quit, she encourages him not to quit, to sit down. That process is something that's probably hurtful. You probably just want to get back into it, but that is where he needs to go for his real talent. And she could see he has real talent. And she's like, let me tell you something that I haven't told anyone in this class except two other people. I was married to a very abusive man who was physically violent with her. And while this definitely does not negate any of Sally's sociopathic behavior, I could see where it stems from. And it's even more sad, and I do have just a pinch of sadness for her, that she finds herself back in a different type of abusive relationship, just not in the way she expects. She asked to do a play with him, and he agrees. And then it jumps to a few weeks later, and I really thought at the beginning of this it was one of his flashbacks that he has with Sally, because they're in a hammock, they're reading over their lines. She is all kissing all over him, so they seem to be a couple at this point, now that she can see he has quote-unquote worth. And then she says, Janice is here. And I'm like, the fuck? And there she is. Janice is right there visiting Gene in his country home. They have reignited their relationship. They're calling each other babe. They're hugging all over each other, kissing all over each other. Sally and Barry seem to be in a good place. Everything's compliments. It's just a couple enjoying coupling things. She says she came and was interrupting their practice. They have a show that they're doing together. She's like, Barry Block. And he's like, yeah, that's my stage name. I thought it was better than Berkman. Is it? Gene comes out. He sings to his sweetheart in a Jamaican song, how cute. And then they sit down to have dinner. And then shit goes sideways, because Gene brings up how talented Barry is and knew so when he gave his first monologue, which revealed that he was a hitman, used to serve in Afghanistan, and now thinks that killing is all that he can do. I love how this scene is played, because the danger in the air to the other two oblivious spouses in that moment. And then Moss, she can't give anything away. She can't, because she, not only is this not confirmed, right? She's putting two other people in possible danger. So her instincts kick in, like two additional things that I just learned about this person that was not brought up previously, which may have affected this initial hunch that she was beginning to have about Barry. It intrigues her. It intrigues her because she's just that type of detective. So even if she didn't in that moment fully realize what that meant, Barry certainly did. And Barry didn't underestimate what kind of detective that Moss was, which is why he felt the need to frame everything so that it could be tied in a bow to not lead back to him, which he did rather brilliantly. so brilliantly that once again we forgot that this is a lethal killer. Moss shifts the conversation to Sally and asks if she wants to go on a ride along. Then we see later on that Barry is in his bed. He knows that Moss is gonna know. And that's exactly what we see. She creeps out the house. She goes and finds the Wi-Fi. She goes on to Facebook and there it is. Barry Block, friends with Chris and Taylor on Facebook. Barry comes out, begs her, let's just forget about it. Don't pursue this. She pulls out her gun. She says, you know, it doesn't work like that. You can tell she's genuinely upset. She's got tears in her eyes. She knows this is going to hurt Gene. This is going to hurt Sally. However, he has hidden a gun for this exact possibility. And unfortunately, when shots ring out, I love that shot of Sally in bed. And we just see in the background the exchange of gunfire. And then he crawls back into bed and he says, starting now, that his criminal life is over, but it's not going to be. I think him killing Moss was probably, I mean, that's whatever he could have had at that moment, some peace that, you know what, I've done wrong. I've hit the point of no return. The fact that he continued to go, there's nowhere else, that now he's officially irredeemable. And it goes back to what they were saying, like, if you kill people outside of war, you're a fucking psychopath. And you have the idea that he was trained by Fuchs to only kill bad people, right? He goes back to that same war mentality that Fuchs is able to put over him. But then that one scene as he's talking to Sally and getting personally what he wants in his life, you see the picture of Ryan being taken off the wall, and you're recalled back to that moment in episode 2 where his father was up there and praising everybody and he was crying about who could do this to his son. So he was loved. He knows this wasn't a bad person, and yet he besmirched his entire memory. Then you see what he did to Chris, and now you see what he's done to Moss. He's officially, from that point forward, gone to the point of no return. I was so upset when I knew Moss was dead, like around the third shot. No! He was finally happy. Gene was super happy. Or she was finally happy. And she did look amazing. And unfortunately, I mean, what did he do with her body? Clearly he had to have done something with her body, because if there's an investigation where there's a body, you know, versus she disappeared or something like that, or she can't be found, that leaves more of a search party. But this is eventually going to turn inward. I think Barry thought that was going to be the end of it, but unfortunately it's not the end of it. And he still has Fuchs out there. He still has Fuchs out there, who clearly still has a hold on him, no matter how much he bespokes how he's done with that life. So a really good episode. I love the complexities of the character. I know I haven't mentioned enough how Bill Hader's acting is amazing. Clearly he has won some awards for this show, as I said last episode, but maybe didn't effeud enough. That scene in the car between him and Chris, that was a standout scene of the episode, or of the season thus far. Just so good that scene was. So I don't understate or undervalue what Bill Hader is bringing to this series and all the other actors that are supporting him. They've been pretty damn outstanding, but I really liked Moss, and I'm really sad that she's gone. And I'm really sad for what that could mean for Gene, but I think it does put the audience in the mindset of whatever and how much empathy we can give to, at least on a moralistic standpoint, we can give to Barry. he's the villain. If you want to send feedback, once again, blackgirlcouch@gmail.com, or you can leave a comment below on this podcast. My social media will be there as well. Remember to like, share, and subscribe. Until the next time, peace, hair grease, and black girl magic.